The arrival of monsoon in India is celebrated with the dance of ancient, colorful, jeweled, and delicate insects, often playfully called helicopters, that is our dragonflies. Good evening, everyone. My name is Nikhil John from WWF India, and I'm pleased to welcome our esteemed guests, panelists, and all our audience who are present here and are watching live on YouTube to the launch event of the Dragonfly Festival 2021. The Dragonfly Festival is being organized by WWF India in partnership with National Biodiversity Authority, Zoological Survey of India, UNEP, BNHS, Indian Dragonfly Society, Dragonfly South Asia, Society for Ordnance Studies, India Biodiversity Portal, and MIT WPU. We also have Ms. Nazneen Siddiqui, who has been an important member throughout the entire Dragonfly journey. So very warm welcome to all of you. So today we mark the beginning of the fourth chapter of the Dragonfly Festival, a celebration to demystify the dragonflies and damselflies around us. So before we begin, let's look at the agenda for the day. So starting with a formal invite by Ms. Radhika Suri, followed by a panel discussion with our dragonfly experts, after which we will walk you through this year's festival, and then we will officially launch the Dragonfly Festival 2021. Now, without further ado, I invite Ms. Radhika Suri, Director, Education, WWF India, to formally welcome and give you a glimpse of the festival from 2020. Ms. Radhika Suri, over to you.
Thank you so much, Nikhil, and a very good afternoon to all of you. This is a very beautiful season and one of my favorites, the season of rain. And what really, you know, makes it so special is that nature looks so refreshed and there is so much activity in nature. I remember and recall, you know, when we started the first dragonfly, festival, I remember that morning when I was leaving home, my daughter said, "Well, do you have an event today?" And I said, "Yes, it's a dragonfly festival." And she turned around and said, "Dragonflies? Oh, let me Google that." And that day, it really struck me that in this one generation, how much had changed. I grew up with dragonflies playing with me and, you know, being around me. And suddenly with my children, they didn't even see it in nature and they seem to have disappeared. So that statement really, you know, stayed close to my heart and also, reinforced that, you know, we do need such festivals. We do need to come together to, you know, raise awareness. In WWF India, we say together possible. So that's something we believe with our heart and soul. And today it gives me immense pride. All these partners who are here are not, just logos. They are partners who have joined this movement. When we started it, it was just BNHS and WWF. And what is so interesting about this partnership is we have a representation from the government, from the science fraternity, and from the technology side too. So that's what makes this festival so, so special, that how over the years, everybody is coming together to raise awareness and actually collect data on dragonflies. We also in WWF believe that conservation of the environment is not just organization work. We all have a part to play in this. And what I really find very fascinating of festivals and projects like this is that we are able to actually contribute. We all have a role to play and we actually can contribute. Citizen science is absolutely exciting because it opens a different avenue, a window for you where you go through a very fascinating journey while you're contributing to science. So that's, I think, so the beauty and we really need to acknowledge that we have a role to play too. And action is important. And why dragonflies? Dragonflies are, they have very interesting names. Just look at this. There's a granite ghost and there's a scarlet open wing. Wow, such fascinating names. But they're very, very special because they one is that they do maintain a balanced ecosystem. And every little creature on this planet has a role to play. And it is very important to also give attention to these lesser known species. And that's the whole idea behind this festival. In 2008, I'll give you a little glimpse of what happened. So it was, I remember, the BNHS team and us just said, hey, what about a dragonfly festival? And every BNHS said, yeah, that sounds exciting. So 2018 is when we started this festival. It was on ground and it was a simple festival. We did campus counts. And I think so we observed around 25 different species in Delhi. It was in one location. We found it very exciting. We found everybody very excited about it. And next year we said, okay, let's take this forward. There was also Nazneen, who was, very passionate about dragonflies, had collected amazing data. And so she played a very strong role in this. And she had compiled a book and she wanted to publish that. And that's how the next journey came in 2019, where it was BNHS and the Indian Dragonfly Society. And we launched our first field guide on dragonfly and damselflies. So we were on an interesting journey, but yes, 2020 brought a sea change to the whole festival. Well, it was the pandemic and you would say, what happened? I mean, how did you manage to, scale this? But what happened in 2020 was fascinating because we were able to reach across the country. 2020, even though it was tough, technology helped us to make many, many observations, which I won't tell you, you will hear about it soon. And it had very interesting components. There was a nice kit you could take. There were backyard counts. There were lots of contests. There was expert sessions. There were date with dragonflies. So there were lots and lots of fun things that happened in this festival. But the biggest force in WWF, yes, we have state offices. We are a team, a big team. But to achieve this, we had a core group of 81 trained volunteers who took this forward across the country. We reached 10 states of India. They conducted a multitude of webinars they had lots of expert talks and it reached across the country. And a lot of data was also collected. So it's as you can see, it's had a beautiful journey from one city. It's already in 10 states and it has this beautiful community, the strong community coming together to take this forward. In 2020, one thing that really was special was that we collected a lot of data on the iNaturalist app and on the India Biodiversity Portal. So that was something that really, took this festival a notch up and to the next level. I will not tell you more about this because I will call my partner, Thomas, from India Biodiversity Portal to give us a little glimpse of what happened to all this data analysis and what did we actually achieve in 2020. So Thomas, welcome and over to you.
Thank you, Radhika. Can everyone hear me and see my screen?
We can hear you, yes.
Okay. Thank you, Radhika. So, Yeah, as Radhika introduced very well captured the background of the Dragonfly Festival. And IBP actually joined in a little, India Biodiversity Portal joined in a little late into the festival. And we started the Dragonfly Festival in about October 2020. We served as one of the partners of the citizen science component of the festival. And so what I'm trying to present here today is a brief analysis of the data that we have aggregated on the India Biodiversity Portal. And hopefully that, talk about a few things that will probably, point out the benefits of citizen science in a festival like this, and to aggregate information and data for dragonflies in India. Can we go to the next? Thank you. So, as I said, we started sometime in October 2020, and the festival went on, but the bulk of our observations came in until December 2020, and this is mainly what we have used for the analysis. We were able to aggregate around 3,000 observations of dragonflies on the portal, and over 164 uploaders contributed these observations over this period. And if you consider the species diversity that was captured at the level out of those that were identified, and that was identified to the level of species, there were about 150 species that was identified. This is quite massive considering the scale and the of participation and the time period of participation. So as you can see here, if you take the week-wise participation, the average weekly observations remain at around 100 to 200 every week. And you can see between October to December, we have had intense participation. In some weeks, even exceeding 500, almost 600 participations in the final week. There are a number of reasons for this, and I'll get into this shortly. So one of the chief, motivations was, that throughout this competition, we announced that there would be prizes incentivizing participation across the festival period. We were offering, certificates of participation for everyone who uploaded more than 50 observations, and some nicely designed custom coasters for everyone who crossed 150 observations. And the top 10 contributors would get a copy of the book on dragonflies and damselflies from WWF Experiences. And also some caps and so on. And this really made a difference, I think. People were keen to be a part of the competitions and really chipped in and really, I would say, competed against each other to get to, to upload observations. This is a list of the top contributors who contributed observations. I could just mention a few names here. Aniruddha Singhamabhatra from West Bengal, and Sonu Kumar from Rajasthan, as well as Elavarasan from Tamil Nadu. And you can see a list of the other names as well. So, there was intense participation during this period with more than 400 records from a couple of people coming in, and being contributed. Next slide. And if you look at the spatial distribution of the participation from where the observations are contributed, you can see that there's quite a spread, covering somewhere Srinagar in the north of India to extreme tips of Tamil Nadu in the south, and intense participation across Kerala and Tamil Nadu, as well as West Bengal. Again, I will talk a little bit more about this. Can you go to the next slide? Yeah, so about 30% of the records came in from West Bengal. And actually, our our most intense participation was from West Bengal, because two or three participants, more than two or three, I should say, or four or five participants contributed hugely from the West Bengal region. And in fact, competing against each other to be to occupy the top spot. The second was Kerala. And Kerala also contributed quite intensely. And there was another reason for this. And the reason was that at the time of the Dragonfly observations, we also started another festival called Kerala BioBlitz, which is conducted by ATRI, and roping in college students from across Kerala to upload observations on the India Biodiversity Portal. And they contributed their observations of dragonflies as well towards the festival. And so you see quite intense participation here also. Now, Rajasthan and Tamil Nadu, again, there are reasons why it's so huge. And these are chiefly because there are one or two individual contributors, again, who are top contributors. And so this is the layout of the statewide distribution. And if you're familiar with citizen science, you will know that the citizen science has an issue with bias. And this is quite representative of the bias, because where the top contributors are, you see the distributions in such states being much higher. And it's not truly representative of the species per se, but more a representation of the participation. If you look at the species being recorded, you will see that Pantala flavescens came in top. Again, I will get back to this, followed by the green marsh hawk and Trochothemis cervulea and so on. There's a detailed list on India Biodiversity Portal or in the report that will come out that you can take a look at. But chiefly, these are the top species that will be being contributed during the festival. Next, please. Yeah, so for those who are not familiar with scientific names, I've just put on the top five species here. You can see the wandering glider is the top, the green marsh hawk, the ruddy marsh skimmer, the ground skimmer, the ditchell, as well as the pied paddy skimmer came in next, and I think that is quite widely reported in Kerala. Now, what is the significance of these? You know that some of these are bioindicator species, some of these are migratory. We'll talk a little bit more about that. But you can see here that if you look at the top species week after week, it kind of goes up and down. But one species, the wandering glider, has more or less constantly occupied the top spot. Why? I don't know. So this is something we have to look at carefully during analyzing data collected from citizen science, because we also offered special prizes for observations of Pantala. Pantala itself is a very, can you move on to the next, please? So Pantala is a very interesting species that I'm sure a lot of us here are very interested in, because it is also called the wandering glider or the globe skimmer or globe wanderer. And this is because it is a migratory species. And you can see in the chart below, a representation from the Global Biodiversity Information Facility, that it is the most widespread dragonfly on the planet. It's spread across the world. But it's more of interest because it's migratory, and it is known to do the most, farthest migration of all insect species. And it's multi-generational, in which, the species starts out migrating, but, the ones that return are not the same generation, but the successive generations that return to the same spot. So it completes several life cycles as it migrates. And this, it covers, each dragonfly covers almost 6,000 kilometers from India to Africa, trying to evade the monsoon and go before the monsoons arrive. But it's also interesting in the fact that some of these individuals do not migrate. Disclaimer here, I'm no expert on dragonflies. I'm interested in dragonflies, and this species really interests me for its migratory behavior. So the fact that some species, some of these dragonflies migrate and some do not, makes it also slightly tricky to trace through observations, the path taken by dragonflies and the temporal spread of these species. because you're looking at two populations which may or may not be migratory. Next slide. Yeah, so this is a representation of just the Pantala observations that came in week after week on the India Biodiversity Portal. Now you can see that there's a huge peak here during the latter part of the festival. Now, some of you would instantly say that's because of increased migration being reported in that period. But again, we have to look at this data in its entirety. Yes, there was an increase in repeat in reports of Pantala during this season. But is it actually because of migration? Is it because we were incentivizing incentivizing reports of the species during that period? I don't know. Is there some other reason for this? So, for instance, during the other weeks and during the other parts of the year, we did not get enough reports of Pantala. So is it because of the festival itself that these Pantala observations are being increasingly reported? And so from this point, yeah, can you move on? Yeah, this is a spatial, charting out the distribution of Pantala spatially across seasons. So you can see here that, starting in January, February, March, there are very few records. In January, there are a few records in the south. March, April, we don't have much observations at all, one or two observations in March and April. And then September, you see a slight increase in the north. But if you look at this, it's more noise until you come to around September. You can see suddenly there is a spurt in observations going across both south as well as north. You can see clearly that there's a peak in Rajasthan. And this I can say for sure that is because of one individual who has reported observations from Rajasthan. So we need to really, we have around 300 records of Pantala on India Biodiversity Portal. We have around 11 to 12,000 for the entire world on GBIF. But this data is not enough. We don't really, it cannot really show what is happening with Pantala. How is it migrating? It does not really bring out this from the observation data alone. We need much, much more intense data, much, much denser data over space and time to really work out what is happening with species such as this, which is why citizen science. Can you move to the next one, please? Yeah, to summarize, so we need much more data to create baselines and to detect patterns, because sporadic observations observed during intense periods will not really help us bring out these patterns, because it will introduce more bias than help us detect patterns. So which is why we need to spread out citizen science across time and aggregate data on a sustained basis through long-term festivals such as the Dragonfly Festival, which can motivate and help raise awareness and help individuals join in and participate across an extended period of time rather than just a week or so, so that data will come in more sustained and raise the awareness. And we can also do this for other dragonfly species, which are bioindicators and so on. There's a whole lot waiting to be discovered. Are there connections between reports of species such as where are the common bitch jewel? They say it's an indicator of pollution. We can actually if you have enough data, we can correlate the polluted areas to the spread of to the distribution of dragonflies and see is this actually being representative enough. And can we use dragonflies as indicators of polluted ecosystems and so on through just citizen science data? So I'll just conclude by saying that we now have the India Biodiversity Group, India Biodiversity Portal Group on Dragonfly Festival 2021, the link of which is shown below. Not sure if you can see. But if you go to IBP, you will see the Dragonfly Festival group. And from today onwards, it's open for contributions. So you can join in and participate by uploading your observations. And I just want to thank WWF, VNHS, and everybody, all the partners involved for organizing this and helping to make this a great success. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Thomas. for sharing a detailed report about the Dragonfly Festival 2020. So remember, guys, do join the India Biodiversity Portal group. It has been created and it is live from today onwards. Okay, so let's move forward and let's go to our panel discussion. And I would like to introduce our moderator for today, Ms. Chetna Kyat. So Chetna, over to you.
Yes, thank you. Thank you, Nikhil. A very, very warm welcome to all of you, especially to our guests and our lovely attendees, both on Zoom and on YouTube. Thank you. Now it's time for the panel discussion. And can we have next slide, please, Nikhil? Yes. So we have with us a lovely panel of experts today. And our topic for the panel discussion is dragonflies and citizen science. I would like to introduce them to all of you. First, I would like to start with Professor Dr. B.K. Tyagi. He's the director of Indian Dragonfly Society. He's a renowned entomologist and well known for his significant contribution on epidemiology and management of vectors and vector-borne diseases. He has discovered many new species of dragonflies and mosquitoes and published many books and research titles related to them. A very warm welcome to you, Dr. Tyagi. Next, we have Dr. K. A. Subramaniam, the scientist E and officer in charge, Southern Regional Center, Zoological Survey of India. He has done phenomenal work on odonatas and freshwater biodiversity conservation. His comprehensive field guide on dragonflies and damselflies of peninsular India is a well-known publication to all. A very, very warm welcome to you, Dr. Subramaniam. It's a pleasure to have you with us today. Next, I would like to welcome Mr. Sohail Madan, Center Management and BNHS, Delhi. He has been the center management for the last 8 years and been instrumental in planning and developing the largest butterfly park in northern India, situated inside the Asola Bhati Wildlife Sanctuary. He has played a crucial role in advising the Department of Forest and Wildlife Government of NCT Delhi on implementing restoration projects and biodiversity surveys. A very warm welcome to you, Mr. Madan. It's a pleasure to have you as well. And lastly, we have Dr. Pankaj, who is an evolutionary ecologist and assistant professor at MIT WPU. He's also the driving force and a member of the Indian Dragonfly Society, South Asia Society. His work on odonates of northern Western Ghats has given an insight into the habitat requirements of the endemic dragonflies and damselflies. A very, very warm welcome to you, Dr. Pankaj, as well. So can we, Nikhil, if you can close the slides and we can have, yes, thank you. So to begin with, I would like to ask the first question to Dr. Subramaniam, that India boasts a wide variety of odonata species, and you have done some extensive research on them in the Western Ghats. What is that one interesting feature or trait according to you that you find? And if you would like to also share one of the most interesting memory or experience you had on the field as well.
Oh, thank you, WWF. Thank you, Chetna, for inviting me. So as you know, like India is very rich in biodiversity. And of course, we have more than 500 species of dragonflies. We are still discovering several new species and new records to the country, thanks to all the entomologist and dragonfly enthusiastic working. And the most interesting aspect of the dragonfly fauna of India is that, so we have several species of dragonflies that is endemic to India. And also some of these, the origin of some of these is still a mystery, because if you look at the fossil records or if you look at the their evolutionary history, you see that some of them are of Gondwanian origin, especially the species that is found in the southern Western Ghats, and also some of the species found in the Northeast have a very ancient evolutionary history. So evolutionarily, some of these species are very, very interesting. Other thing is that many of these species that are endemic or found in the forest areas require very highly specific habitats. So especially there are several species that is inhabiting in the primitive forest types like the Meristica swamps in the southern Western Ghats, then their habitat is really threatened. and their distribution is very, very limited, like limited to maybe one or two streams. So some of them are so narrowly endemic, they are restricted to few, very few habitat patches. So that is one interesting aspect. And the whole journey of in search of dragonflies was fascinating. But the most interesting thing I would say is that seeing a dragonfly above 4,000 meter in Himalaya was the most interesting thing. Though it was a very most commonest dragonfly, Pandala flavescens, I would say recording Pandala flavescens more than 4,500 meter in Himalaya was the most fascinating thing, because a dragonfly could reach up to that level. So it shows how widely distributed this Pandala flavescens, and also how far they can reach in search of their habitat. So this, I think, this was the most fascinating thing I think that is like. So.
Thank you, Dr. Subramaniam. I think that is absolutely very fascinating as well. Like finding a dragonfly at 4,000 meters is absolutely great. And our young audience must be very interested, like how did they find it? What did they do and everything? So we also have a young panelist among us, Dr. Pankaj. We know that dragonflies are lesser known species. And what made you dive deeper into the world of dragonflies? What is inspiring you to continue the research?
Okay, so I think like most of the naturalists or most of the ecologists, I started with birds, because birds are quite plenty around, and there are a lot of, you know, educational material available on taxonomy and, you know, in general on ornithology. Well, in 2009, Dr. Subbu published a book called Dragonflies and Damselflies of the Peninsular India. And that was, I think, the first comprehensive field guide for India. So when I got that book, a copy of that book, well, sir, I didn't pirate it. I got an authentic copy. So then I was looking at dragonflies, but I was not able to identify them. But when I got this book, I started identifying the dragonflies, and I could actually, you know, see that there is so much of diversity, and you can actually name the dragonflies. I think that's a fun part. So there was this one species called coral-tailed cloudwing, and if you, you know, see this male of this dragonfly in the forest, you can actually see those blue beautiful patches on the wings. So the name is so apt, and you can actually discover these different colors on the dragonfly. That was really fascinating for me. So I would say that it's because of field guides, which, you know, eminent ornithologists such as Dr. Subbu and, you know, few other panelists who made, it's because of this, our generation, we could actually access this hidden treasure in the forest. So that was a turning point for me.
Yes, I think, yes, books play a very, very important role. And I think thanks to Dr. Subramaniam, we have you doing extensive research on dragonflies as well. So what a fantastic panel we have today. Going from books.
Just a small intervention. So I would like to say that it's not me. So actually, like Professor Tyagi would definitely agree. So something happened after 2000. So the digital camera and internet became very popular. So before 2000, if you look at, there is extensive literature on dragonfly. Only thing was, it was not printed in color, or it was not easily accessible to people. So after 2000, the digital camera and internet made the things very, very easily accessible to people. And it's not that it was not, a lot of literature is there. And Professor Tyagi definitely know about so whole lot of people. I think he can talk endlessly on whole lot of people who have contributed tremendously to the knowledge on Indian dragonfly. So the evolution, and like especially there were people like Dr. T.R. Mitra and other people who have done a lot of work on dragonflies of Eastern India, and all those publications are available in black and white form. So it was not easily accessible that time, but after 2000, because of internet and all those other facilities, it became very easily accessible.
Yes. Thank you, Dr. Subramanian, for adding to that. And my question to Dr. B.K. Tyagi, because Dr. Pankaj, you spoke about publications, and Dr. Tyagi, you have been associated with many books and journals. And as we have just heard from our panelists, that they play a very, very important role. But do you think there is a gap in the publication space or dragonflies for the children or the non-scientific community? And how do we fill that void more effectively and allow more people to be interested in the world of dragonflies? Just a second, you're on mute. I will unmute you just in a bit.
Yeah, I've done it. Thank you very much, Chetna, and my gratitude to the entire WWF team and all the partners. Dr. Swahili is there, Dr. Kuparudin, Dr. Subramanian. Both of them have been very humble in not realizing their contribution to odontology. They have done marvelously and extensively. Well, as you said, dragonflies are important, I would say, more than the dragonflies today. The books and the literature are of great importance. Books are possibly the best accomplices of man. And for the children, they build their future. As far as the dragonflies literature is concerned, a lot of literature prevailed right from the time of Fabricius and Linnaeus. But possibly the best of all was written by Tilliard in 1917, The Biology of Dragonflies, and which must be always on the desk of a dragonfly worker. If a dragonfly worker hasn't read that, I would say he would never be a complete odontologist. There have been books of greater importance written by particularly Dr. F.C. Fraser, the man who has composed the three volumes of Fauna of British India on Odonata, and his magnum opus on the classification of Odonata, called Reclassification of Odonata, written by Fraser along with Tilliard way back in 1957, is a classic one. Anyone interested in taxonomy must go through that. There have been many other wonderful literature in the field of journals, like there was an international journal called History Continuing, Odonatologica, not only Odonatologici, Cilicia from America, Tombo from Japan, and so many countries are contributing. I have a book recently written about 3 years ago in the honor of one of the greatest odontologists still surviving, around 85 now. This book gives you information about all the literature on dragonflies, both from the world as well as India. The point here is, what we lack here in these books is that these books are of a very high technical minds. The children, particularly school-going children and the college-going students, are generally not in touch with them. They do not know anything about this book unless they come to the research side of the future vocational requirements. It is very important for us to see that these important creatures, biology, are transformed into kinds of lovable stories, lovable booklets. There are many books available on the Amazon where the dragonflies had been the subject of many books for children. You find almost 36. I went through the Google and I found more than 36 books written specifically for children, school-going and college-going students. And it is so marvelous to see that they are not talked of great vanishing or flight mechanism involving all the science into that. They are talked about with all the beauties of life, how the life takes up, how the dragonfly breeds, how it lays the eggs, how the generation starts in the water, how the molting continues in the water for many generations, how the adult is born out of the water bug, and that beautiful dragonfly, how does it take on the wings. All those things, when they are described in a poetic, rhetoric manner, in a way that the child tries to merge himself with that. Like my grandmother or grandfather used to tell us the stories of the bad time, and we have still never forgotten. Every word of them is imprinted in my mind. In the same way, if we do that, I think the literature will become a golden literature, not only for Odonita, but also for the children who need to know about the dragonflies, because they are one and only one group of the organism which connect directly with the purity of the environment, both in the aquatic and the aerial state of the environment. I think this is very important, and WWF is in the forefront. I'm very happy to see so many partners have come together with the WWF. This kind of integrity had been needed for many, many years. When I continued my journey way back in 1974, we started with only three people, myself, Dr. Mahabir Prasad, and Dr. Suri Babu, gathered in Mysore during Indian Science Congress to start something like a dragonfly office of Indian International Ornithological Society. My point is this: today we have such a wonderful integrated body with the 10 partners with different minds and technologies available. Let us start something which make dragonflies connected directly with the students and the school going children. This will change the entire scenario of the future. Thank you very, very much.
Thank you, Dr. Tyagi. A very, very valid point. So I think stories are something that we remember from our childhood, and that is the first thing that connects any child to biodiversity, be it dragonflies or birds or anything. So storybooks are definitely a very important role. Mr. Madan, we spoke about children being an important resource, and how important is it to bring in them the forefront about dragonfly loss. But when we talk about biodiversity decline, we basically focus on the megafaunas like the tigers or the elephants. However, it has been noticed, and even came in the LPR report of 2020 of WWF, that even the smaller organisms are decreasing, and even there they are under stress. However, we don't have proper scientific records. So what role do you think can citizen science play in bringing the importance of and conservation of dragonflies in the forefront?
Thank you, Chetna. First of all, I would like to say I'm privileged to be with such experts of the field, and every session with these scientists always is a learning opportunity. Very excited to be here for the 2021 launch and to see so many known and unknown faces in today's session. With that, to answer your question, I feel the focus on megafauna is important. They are representatives of our jungles and forests, and they play a very important, vital role in all our conservation efforts. But as you just mentioned, there are multitudes of studies now which are showing that insect population, dragonflies, and also insects on a whole, are declining all over the world. And the special, very special thing about insects is that we see them all around us. We don't have to go to a forest, especially in our urban areas. We don't have the access, or we don't have the opportunity to see megafauna. But dragonflies, insects are all around us. They have a deep connection with the health of our environment. Dragonflies have a direct connection with the mosquito population. They are biocontrollers for mosquitoes, which as we know, if dragonflies go away, there'll be more mosquitoes that we are seeing all across our cities. Cases of malaria and dengue are on the rise every year. Same goes with wetlands. Dragonflies are closely associated with wetlands, wetlands being their important habitats. And if you see Delhi or Chennai or any of these big cities now in India, we have a water crisis. All the wetlands are gone or in very, very bad conditions and need revival. So there's a possibility of instant connection that can be made with wild creatures that live among us. And this is where I see citizen science coming in. People want to do stuff. If there is a way that citizenry programs like these go a long way doing that, the citizenry can be informed, educated on the interesting, important aspects of these fascinating insects, they can drive a movement for conservation of not just these insects, but areas around them. Informed citizenry would be our biggest weapon in our conservation fight. If we want to really take up this fight in a substantive manner, we have to go to the general citizen and we have to have informed citizenry taking decisions based on sound ecological knowledge. Apart from that, scientists, as you know, we are losing insects faster than we can discover them. So there is a huge gap in the scientific knowledge on insects in India. Scientists need citizens to take up this mantle, to help them study such insects over a large area like our country and over a long period of time. This data is really going to be helpful, as Thomas was just has just illustrated in front of us. Such fascinating data can come out of it. This can be really helpful for the scientific community and really required, I would say, by the scientists. They require all these citizens to help them get to the science of insects. And in my opinion, the younger generation is really, really willing to help. Our role is to create programs where they're given an avenue to really contribute in a meaningful way, contribute to science, contribute to betterment of their local wetlands or areas around their own home. You know, take ownership of every place like it's a wild place and try and save it. Save the greenery that exists and let your work in the field inform your decisions, be it for voting or be it for any decision being or for buying something. Such deep involvement with nature, I think, can lead to a lot of personal changes in people's lives also. As we have been doing, you have been associated with this program for a long time. You know the trends. Every year we are getting bigger and better participation, more meaningful data. I think there's a huge potential for all citizen science programs in India. We could be the global leaders in such programs if we put in the right infrastructure. And I think we are going in the right direction with all the portals that are coming in and all the people putting in such hard work into creating programs like this. So of course there's a huge potential, but something I would like to add here is we should just not be concentrating on identification of dragonflies and collating occupancy data of it was here, it wasn't here kind of data. We should also be looking at ecology and behavioral aspects of these insects. I would encourage all young students to start writing short notes, try and get them published in nature magazines like Sanctuary Asia, or there's a publication called BioNotes, which is only exclusively publishing observational notes based on no data at all. I think if over 10, 15 years such data is collected, it could help us form conservation strategies in the future when we really want to, you know, when policy makers really get serious and the focus of conservation is not totally megafauna, it is also insects. We need to be ready for that. We need citizens to contribute to help scientists and take over or take ownership of wild areas around them. They are not for the forest department or the government or some NGO to take care of. Those areas are ours. And I think that's where citizen science would be really important.
Thank you, Ms. Madan. I think I completely agree with you. And WWF always believes in the power of children and youth. And that's why a lot of our programs are focused on children and youth, connecting them to nature. And as Radhika always says, that if they don't dirty their hands, they will not love nature. And if they don't love nature, they're not protected. So thank you very much. I think even our scientific panel will also agree with you that even citizen science contribution is extremely important for their data analysis as well. So we are running a little short. I would have loved to continue this panel discussion, but there's one last question. It's a rapid fire one. It's a surprise one for all of you. Just one rapid question round. I just want one word from you all when you look at a dragonfly. Just one word.
Elegant.
Sorry, sir?
Elegant.
Elegant. Fantastic.
Beautiful.
Yes, definitely. Dr. Subramaniam.
I will agree with Tyagi, sir. It's elegant.
Elegant. Dr. Pankaj, you're on mute. I couldn't hear you. I'm sorry.
Somebody stole my word. I was going to say beautiful, but I'll just say wow.
Yes, definitely. I think I feel they're extremely dynamic. It's the way they fly, it's so beautiful. And thank you all for our lovely panelists. And it's an honor to have all of you there for our Dragonfly launch. Please stay on. We have some exciting launch event happening more.
Thank you very much.
Nikhil, over to you.
Thank you so much, Chetna, for leading this wonderful panel discussion. And now comes the moment we all have been waiting for. That is the launch of this year's Dragonfly Festival. So I would like to invite Dr. V.P. Mathur, Chairperson NBA, Dr. Vivash Pandav, Director of BNHS, Mr. Atul Bagai, Head UNEP India, and Mr. Karan Balla, COO, WWF India, to please join us in the countdown to launch the Dragonfly Festival 2021. So I request our esteemed guest, everyone in the audience too, to join us in the countdown for the launch. Okay, so we will have the countdown right now. So everyone can unmute your mics and say it with me. 10, 9, 8,
7, 6, 5, 4,
2,
1, 0. And congratulations. Woo. Festival is officially launched. And congratulations to everyone. We are looking forward to this next 6 months of active participation. And we have a lot of young children over here. So I'm pretty sure they are excited as well for this wonderful festival and the journey ahead. So now I would request Dr. Vivi Mathur, Chairperson NBA, to kindly share a few words for the festival. Over to you, sir.
Dr. Mathur is in multiple meetings. Dr. Mathur, we need 2 words from you. You need to unmute yourself.
I think Dr. Mathur is facing some technical...
Okay, I'll give him a call. Okay, fine.
Okay, so now I would like to invite Mr. Atul Bagai, Head UNEP India, to say a few words. Atul sir, please.
Okay. Nikhil, I think so. Atul is on the road and he said his internet is unstable. So okay. We'll go back to Dr. Mathur and then Dr. Vivash and then Karan.
Okay.
Dr. Mathur? Can we unmute him, please?
Yes, I think just. Hi, Dr. Mathur.
Yeah.
Hi, Dr. Mathur. If you could share a few words about the festival, over to you, sir.
Okay. Thank you very much for providing me this opportunity. I must admit that I am in a remote location attending another meeting, but I must say that when Radhika and Vishesh approached me and informed me about this festival, I got really very excited. It's not very often that you get to be involved in a festival or in an event which relates to a very tiny little animal. In my earlier avatar at WII, it was tiger that dominated every day. And Vivash is there, he knows that how much time we spent, and not the tiger doesn't need that kind of an effort. But now that I work for a biodiversity authority, I do understand the value of each and every living creature. So I will begin by complimenting the WWF for continuing with this festival. This is, I think, the fourth edition of that. And I do understand that, and today I'm very pleased to see that there are around 300 people who have joined this this event, which itself is a very, very interesting recognition of the fact that there is an interest and people are craving for some knowledge exchange. And events like this, they help you to do that. So all my compliments for that. And then, of course, I did some more understanding and my own literature survey. And I was so happy to note that there are about 500 species of ordinates that we are dealing with. And the role today, at a different level, the world is now involved in developing indicators for the global biodiversity framework. And I don't see Vishesh, but she has been actively involved, and so is WWF. So we are talking of global indicators. How can we forget the tiny biolo indicator, which is present inside our own country? So it may not figure in the global dialogue, but we definitely need to understand that odonates can play a very important role in biomonitoring. And I want to again relate it one more thing. See, at the global level, we are talking of nature-based solutions. And we are telling to the world that cement and concrete is not the answer to meet the damages what we inflict on nature. We need to find a nature-based solutions. And to that extent, I could correlate that today, this insect group that we are talking, the odonates, have a very vital role to deal with the menace of malaria. The entire malarial parasite and the mosquito and so on, they can be very easily controlled. And there are figures to say, I mean, we may differ in the numbers that one dragonfly eats 500 mosquitoes or 100, but that's besides the point. But definitely there is a natural control that we can look at. There is something which has been given by nature to all of us, and we must make the full use of it. So to that extent, my compliments again, even at the point of reiteration, that all our young colleagues who are listening and who are participating this event must get a sense that every creature, every life form has a role to play. And by organizing such events, we help in raising the awareness and we raise the sensitivity, and small human actions can help in conservation of the larger biological diversity of this earth. The last thing I want to say, as I was reading through my notes, I realized that there are countries like UK, like USA, like Japan, who have set up whatever you call it, some call it a dragonfly nature reserve or a dragonfly sanctuary or some area where people can come and visit and see and know a little more about that. These festivals will be important, but I want to propose, and I would like to hear from the group, and there are the dragonfly societies and others who can take the message. Can we set up to start with one or two such areas where we say, and maybe I'm saying that We do have butterflies parks across the country. We can combine the same park and assign an area for dragonfly so that the awareness gets raised. And when you will report and advertise it in people, a natural curiosity will come that, look, there is a dragonfly area or a nature park in our city. We can go and visit that. So that would be very, very important. Not everybody can visit a national park, and not everybody who visits national park can see tiger. But we need to shift the momentum from the large mammal conservation to all species conservation. And to that extent, I would again compliment Radhika and her team for conceiving of that, continuing with that. In these COVID times, it is not easy to organize anything, but definitely you have been able to do that. So compliments once again. And of course, I will apologize that I won't be able to stay longer.
That's fine, Dr. Mathur.
My own meeting. So thank you once again for providing this opportunity and wish you good luck. My colleagues are part of my team, which is collaborating with WWF. And I do understand that your events will continue up to February 2022.
Yes.
And they would be participating in every activity that you would like NBA to do. So on behalf of the National Biodiversity Authority and my own behalf, I congratulate you and I assure my continued support in whatever manner you feel it is required, because your programs are very exciting. I've been participating in them from your MOP parliament to MCOP to everything. So thank you once again.
Thank you so much, Dr. Mathur.
Thank you so much, Dr. Vivi Mathur, for your kind words. Now I would like to invite Dr. Vivash Pandav, Director, BNHS, to share a few words about the festival. Over to you, Doctor.
Good evening, and thanks for taking such a wonderful initiative to organize this. We normally talk about eBird thing everywhere, all over the world, people are busy recording their bird sightings. And in fact, when Radhika wrote to me, I got to know, then I asked Sohail. So I was very encouraged. I mean, this is a wonderful thing. See, we keep talking about saving tigers, saving elephants and all these things. But if you want to see the success of tiger conservation or success of saving elephants, you don't have to look at their tiger number or elephant number. You have to look at actually how many dragonflies are there in the streams of those areas. See, one of the major output of this saving these large mammals is just protecting our natural system and protecting the water that is flowing out of these areas. So, and who else represent a better indicator than dragonflies and damselflies? So I would say it is directly related to the crores of investment that has gone into this country since 1970s or inception of Project Tiger and other things. We seriously look into the dragonfly diversity and dragonfly abundance and dragonfly as indicator species in all these areas. I would like to share another very interesting personal note on dragonflies. I have a colleague who was working with Wildlife Institute of India, a forest officer from Orissa cadre.
Dr. Bhavesh, your mic is gone off. Yeah.
Yeah. I was talking about a colleague of mine who was at the Wildlife Institute of India. It's sort of a walking encyclopedia of everything. You ask him about music, you ask him about Veda, you ask him about English literature, you ask him about Sanskrit. He knows everything. I'm very curious to know how his brain is actually structured. So he was my junior. We did our master's at Wildlife Institute of India. He was my junior, two batches junior to me. And amazing fellow. In 2001, he joined Indian Forest Service. He was alerted Orissa cadre. And then suddenly he got interested to do his PhD. So I thought this fellow is such a genius, and his main keen interest was in plants and was excellent in birding. So I thought either he will do a PhD on birds or PhD on plants. But then at the end of the day, he came up with a beautiful PhD thesis, a wonderful PhD, wonderfully written PhD thesis on dragonflies and damselflies of Orissa. And this forest officer is no other than Dr. Manoj Nair. Manoj Nair currently is with the Lal Bahadur Shastri of Public Administration in Mussoorie, and wonderful person. In fact, I have suggested Radhika to invite him for a talk. And people like Manoj, who actually stunned me. I mean, I had absolutely no knowledge on dragonflies and damselflies. And only after Manoj completed his PhD on the subject, I started taking, at least I should know 10, 15, 20 dragonflies. I should not show my ignorance in front of Manoj. So fear of Manoj, I actually started learning dragonflies. But apart from that, at BNHS, we have a wonderful collection of dragonflies and damselflies in our collection center. BNHS has a collection of nearly 120,000 specimens of all taxa. So dragonfly, damselflies, and butterflies constitute an integral part of our collection. So any given point of time during the festival, we can organize a tour to our collection center. Tour in the sense, virtual tour. I will ask the people in our collection center to display and to talk about some of the interesting dragonflies and damselflies. That will be thing. We can work out a schedule and we can do that. I also encourage people to visit BNHS collection center for reference and for genetic sampling. Also, we are very open to it. It's an open invitation to everyone. So please do visit BNHS and look at the collection center that we have. And if any book publication is being planned by Dr. Tyagi or Subbu or anyone else, BNHS will be very keen to do that along with other organizations. So
thank you.
The offer is open, sir. Any field guide, common dragonflies of the country. I think we need a lot more field guides or in different forms to make the subject very popular. The way butterflies have become very popular because of few field guides. So if we come up with good quality publications, I'm sure Dr. Subbu has excellent one, but common dragonflies and damselflies of India, something like that, what BNHS publishes field guide, it will be a brilliant idea to do that. Let's plan to do that. And once again, congratulations to WWF for taking the lead for this wonderful initiative. We are moving away from tiger and elephants, but remember, tiger elephant conservation success will measured only by dragonflies. How many dragonflies are there in the streams of tiger habitats and elephant habitats? Thank you.
Thank you so much, Dr. Bivash. And as Dr. Bivash mentioned, that we might get a chance to take a tour, a virtual tour of the 1,200 specimens of dragonflies that are there. So that's quite exciting. Now, I would like to invite Mr. Kanumala.
It's not 1,200. We have 120,000 specimens.
120,000. Okay.
All taxa. Yes. I do not know how many dragonflies, damselflies are there, but they are nicely labeled and kept in our collection center. So till October, the collection center is closed. The dry specimens are closed because of high humidity in Bombay. So after October, we'll open our collection center. So anytime after that, we'll organize the tour.
Definitely so. We're looking forward to it. So now I would like to invite Mr. Karan Bhalla, COO WWF India, to share a few words. Sir, over to you.
Thank you, Nikhil, and thank you so much, Dr. Pandav, Dr. Mathur, Mr. Atul Badai, and we've partnered with 10 partners in this event, and it really is a privilege for WWF India to partner with various esteemed organizations who are there on the panel behind Nikhil. You know, as Radhika mentioned, I must thank the panelists too, because there's so much to learn from them. There's so much of interest that our young citizens of tomorrow can actually learn from. And it's great to have a citizen science initiative. It's great to involve young children. And as you know, our colleagues mentioned earlier in the poll, that it really is about generating interest about species like dragonflies, so that people can, and it's something for all of us to see and to understand the web of nature as well as the web of health. We had examples of that earlier in the conversation. So it really is a privilege for us to be a part of this event. And Mr. Ravi Singh, our chief executive, is unfortunately traveling with very poor internet connectivity. So He conveys his apologies and is not able to join. Thank you so much. Over to you, Nikhil.
Thank you so much, sir. Okay, so now the Dragonfly Festival 2021 has been filled with activities for people from all walks of life to learn, share, and conserve the dragons of nature for the next 6 months. So let's take a quick look at what all components does the festival have. So we have designed a stunning webpage for the Dragonfly Festival. Okay. So, yeah. We'll just quickly. So we have designed a stunning webpage for the Dragonfly Festival, and we will share the link with you, all of you, very soon. So are you curious to learn more about dragonflies and want something which you can read? We have the Train for the Dragon section to brush up our knowledge of dragonflies. The next exciting component is called the Date with Dragonflies. It has a monthly live section with all upcoming workshops, expert session, and webinars to keep you updated. All you need to do is to click on the session, click on register, and find the links for the session. The following section is all about you. It gives you an exciting opportunity to contribute our citizen science project by being a part of the backyard count. All you have to do is to join the project on the iNaturalists or India Biodiversity Portal app, click a picture of the dragonfly or damselfly that you've spotted in your balcony, upload and share it with us on the app and the project. If you are a photographer, a painter, a poet, or an artist, we also have some exciting contests for you in store. So don't worry. Are you from and in and around Delhi? We have the perfect field guide for you. Dragonflies and damselflies in and around Delhi is a user-friendly field guide for all age groups, which feature 42 beautiful ordinates in and around Delhi. This book is authored by our very passionate Ms. Nazmi Siddiqui. You can buy a copy for yourself at the given links mentioned on our website. And if you missed your last expert session, by any chance, don't worry, we have got you covered. If in case you missed our last expert session, you can view it on our Dragonfly website. Now, I hope you are now all familiar with our website. Don't forget to keep checking it through the festival. Keep looking, keep sharing, and keep inspiring. Now, for this year's Dragonfly Festival, we are looking forward to your active participation. So, Chetna, what else is there in our store for our lovely audience?
Thank you, Nikhil, for taking us through the webpage. This year, looking at all the experiences from year 2020, we are going across India, pan-India again. We will be working with a young and dynamic group of volunteers, a core group who will be trained by the experts to lead the Dragonfly Festival throughout the country in different states of India, from Delhi, Assam, Madhya Pradesh, West Bengal, Maharashtra, Karnataka, Tamil Nadu, Kerala, and also we have been joined in Jammu and Kashmir as well, which is very exciting. On monthly basis, we will be having a BioBlitz Day from regional as well as state BioBlitz Day. We will be having virtual trails for all of you to actually see the dragonflies in their native habitats. We will create creative sessions for all our creative little young minds who want to draw, write, or learn something new. We will also have live quizzes. We know you all love live quizzes. We will have monthly competitions and a podcast as well. There will be obviously one of the most loved sessions from last year were expert talks. And we have a lovely panel of people with us. So expert talks will be there and also school sessions with all the school children as well. This year, we will also be going in regional languages. So with our expert talks and some school sessions will be conducted in the regional languages of the different state as well. One of the core components of the Biodiversity Festival will remain the citizen science, and we request all of you to join us for the citizen science component. Upload, observe, learn your data. It really, really helps the scientific community in their analysis. We will also be doing a few wetland surveys and sensors where we will be selecting a few wetlands across the country and specifically focusing on them with our young volunteers and doing surveys in these wetlands. So it's a very exciting 6 months for us. So before we go, we have another very exciting thing that is going to take place this year is a Dragonfly publication. I would just give you a little glimpse. Give me a second to take you to the Dragonfly publication. Yes. So we are very excited to launch the Dragonfly and Damselfly fold-out publication for Delhi NCR. It has a few very general information about the dragonflies and damselflies that you can find in and around Delhi and NCR. It's a compact user-friendly guide made especially for children with both general with general information about the odonates and a few very species that you can commonly see in and around. Through the 6 months, we will be replicating this publication for the various states as well. So we are very, very excited to come up with this compact publication as well. So over to you, Nikhil. So what's next in store?
Okay, so thank you so much, Chetna, for the lovely update. So one of our esteemed guests, they've come back. So I would like to invite Mr. Atul Bagai, Head UNEP India, to please share a few words about the festival. Over to you, sir.
Is he unmuted? Can you see him?
I think we again lost the connection. Mr. Atul Bagai.
Yes, I think it's again gone. The message didn't get received. So I think so, Nikhil, let's.
Okay.
Proceed. Yeah.
So thank you everyone for joining in today's session. We are looking for a successful 6 months of amazing journey with your support and the support of all our amazing partners over here. So we have a few updates. So do join our Instagram page. Or we have created a small Instagram page for your Dragonfly Festival. So all updates and picture would be there on the Instagram page. Subscribe to our website that we have created. You will get monthly updates and you will be aware of all the events that are happening. I think Chetna and we guided you very briefly about the website. And for any latest update about any event that is happening, do join our EE Facebook page. So all the links will be put up on the chat box right now. So thank you everyone for joining for the launch event. It was a pleasure to host you all virtually, and we look forward to having you actively involved during the Dragonfly Festival 2021. So thank you so much and have a good weekend ahead.
Thank you very much and wish you all the best in your plans. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Dr. Kelly.
Thank you, Nikhil and Chetna.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks,
everyone.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you to all our guests for coming and sharing their time and views with us for the Dragonfly launch event. And a special thank you to all our viewers and attendees of the Dragonfly Festival. A very happy Independence Day to all of you over the weekend as well. And before we go, do join us over the links that my colleague Ashish is sending over the chat box. Do subscribe to us over the email. We will be sharing all the various components or the activities that are happening throughout the 6 months on your email ID or on the Instagram page as well. So do join and keep updated and do participate in the Dragonfly Festival. Thank you.
Splendid, splendid, wonderful. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you, sir. Thank you very much.